11th, 2013. This week, I laid out my vision for the very first time publicly. And that vision is that I absolutely believe in 1 year's time, we can achieve world peace on this planet. I believe that for many reasons. There are a ton of spokes to this wheel of that particular vision. Spokes that both explain why I believe it and how I believe it's going to be done. It can be done. Without a doubt, my year at Microsoft made me believe this. Oh God, that year at Microsoft is what sealed the deal. That is how I knew that it was absolutely possible. What do I mean by that? Well, let me see if I can try to paint the picture a little bit. I am part of a lot of networks that are small percentage networks. I've already pointed out to you, we live in this country, we're educated, and we have computers. That right there puts us in a super small percentage of the world. Of the world. Maybe not in this country, but just being in this country puts us... Folks, this is about a greater responsibility. And I know by opening that door to talk about this, it opens me up for, who does she think she is? You know, that sort of thing. And I'm not going to spend, you know, the time is coming to an end where I'm even going to bring this up, you know, and try to explain to people. If you haven't got it yet, I'm not better than anybody. We are all being called to raise the level of our game, to use a sports analogy, to be a little bit better in our lives. And it's very relative. Only you know in what area you can be better. And the craziness in our world, chances are you all, people watching, tend to watch a lot more news than me. I don't watch it. But again, there are some big things you can't ignore. There's a lot of crazy going on. And as we shift, we are shifting into, there is an awakening going on. There is. And it's okay. It's not anything anybody needs to be afraid of. It is the most beautiful time in the world to be alive. We have immense, immense power to create what our reality is. And as this old world that didn't believe that falls away, and as the new world where you've got more and more people who might not be able to name it, but they feel it. They know something different's got to be better, like got to be possible. And it's hard for us to see how dire it is if you live a bubbled life. And the reality is that the majority of the networks that I'm in, because I myself, and it's not a mainstream, non-mainstream grouping, and I refrain from groupings, but it sort of is. And that's for another talk as well. The point being that it's easier to kind of take care of your own unit and to believe that the crazy will never affect you. But with some of the things that have been going on in very common places, it can. We've got to do something. And those of us that have the intellectual capacity have a greater responsibility. And generally speaking, people with very high levels of intellectual capacity are not going to be really receptive to this hippy-dippy, airy-fairy stuff that's been coming out of my mouth for 3 years, right? Start talking about spiritual awakening, start talking about, you know, law of attraction, creating your own realities, manifesting, meditation, visualization. These are words and concepts that are not part of the mainstream world. That's not a judgment. It's coming from somebody who lived in the mainstream world up until I was 33 years old. Like, tried, right? And as such, when I say that, it was just a very limited experience. Just limited. You know, I went to college, I got all my A's, I did my achieving. Thank God I'd studied abroad, right? Naturally, that's what threw my life completely upside down, was when I went to Australia. That changed my world completely, and I didn't know how to get off the train. I knew I was heading for a marriage, a job, all of it, that I knew I was completely on the wrong path. What was revealed to me about myself when I went to Australia by myself as a study abroad student. But I didn't have the courage. I didn't know, well, first I didn't know what to do. I didn't know how to get off the train. So I stayed on the mall, and I went to PricewaterhouseCoopers, and then I got engaged, and then I got married, and then I had to crawl myself out of those things that I was doing more for others than I was for myself, because I did not know how to tune into myself. As an overachieving, very bright, I was an athlete, a star athlete, and a star student, and in those two worlds, everything is externally validated. I didn't know how to figure out who I really was without that external stuff. And I, as such, got into the world and into various jobs with similar people. Not to say that, you know, like, I'm not saying that anybody, I'm not using any names. I'm saying that we all had similar experiences. And adversity, that is how you learn what you're made of. That's why sports are so awesome. It's the adversity that you face on the field or on the court to see what you're really made of, right? And generally speaking, very bright people come from homes that are, you know, at least on the surface, you know, pretending that things are okay. We all got crazy stuff at home as well. But you just don't see, you're not spending time with people that have been in jail, with people that have, I don't know, experience with drugs or crime or homelessness or struggle or abuse, or like the list goes on and on. And yet the majority of our country, the majority of our country are experiencing these sorts of things. And because our country is the way that it is, the freedoms that we have, and mostly, man, the ability to have credit. Hey, I'm thankful because I wouldn't be where I am without the credit, but it allows people to live and do things so beyond their means. And just, if you don't know who you are and you're out there trying to find your way, you can pretty much set your whole life up for struggle really quickly. Really quickly. And, you know, my whole company and my life is now rooted, and has been for 2 years, in a very different game. I can explain the new game, but I can't explain it succinctly. And